Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this Monday edition of National Matters. I am your host, Pastor Moses Chiluba. I must say that it is an honor and privilege for me on this day of our Lord to host His Honor, the former Vice President of the Great Republic of Zambia, Mr. Enoch Kavindere. Sir, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much, Pastor. Thank you.
How is our mother and the family?
No, we are all well. Thank you very much. Yes, you know, we are well.
Sir, when we were in school, we were learning about your politics and all this. Who is Mr. Kavindere? When did you join politics? What came first, business or politics?
Business came first. Mm-hmm. Yes, I was in business, and at that time, then the party UNIP needed some business people mm-hmm. to come into politics and interact.
Pastor Victoria and Moses Chiluba, the Healing Word Ministries International.
Starting on the 3rd to 6th December 2020,
Dr. Francis Miles from the USA returns to Zambia for a conference on issuing restraining orders.
Because you see, God responds to your revelation. So if you approach God as the healer, He heals you. If you approach Him as your shepherd, He will touch your soul. But if you approach Him judicially, He will show you He's the cause.
Venue, the Healing Word Ministries International in Ibex Hill. Time,
17 hours to 19 hours from Thursday to Saturday.
And on Sunday from 09 hours to 11 hours. For more details, call +260 962 965 883. You do not want to miss this conference this time.
Franco Technologies Limited, keeping you first and ahead in business. Franco provides one-stop automated solution for your trade and industry. We have different products and services to meet your requirements in computing and information technology services. Consultancy and development, marketing, advertising, public relations and media consultancy, strategy planning, assessment, procurement, re-engineering solutions, planning audits, level 1 and 2 desktop support, network maintenance and troubleshooting or network setup 1 and LAN design, network security and threat management solution, disaster recovery and storage management solution, hardware sales and support services, servers, computers, computer accessories, Cisco switch, structure cabling system, wireless and routers, antivirus, equipment maintenance, web development and design, database management and programming. We are located at stand number 24676 Hillview Park, Liwala South, Lusaka. Email info@franco-limited.com or contact us on +260 955 095 301 or +260 977 798 218. Franco Technologies Limited, keeping you first and ahead in business.
Our dear Cabinet viewers, we sincerely apologize for that technical challenge, and we really apologize. Like I said, I'm your pastor, Pastor Chiluba, and in the studio with me, I have His Honor, the former Vice President of the Republic of Zambia, Mr. Enoch Kavindere. Sir, welcome once again.
Thank you very much, Pastor Chiluba.
We apologize for that technical challenge.
These things happen all the time.
Your Honor, sir,
right.
I asked a question, which came first, politics or business? But you started explaining.
Yes, Pastor, I was in business.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and then time came when politics needed some people from the business angle of things, and I was one of those. So firstly, I became a representative of the party, UNIP, at council, Lusaka City Council. So I became a councillor there, together with the late President Michael Sata.
Where were you a representative? Of the council, this Lusaka Council.
Yes, Lusaka Council.
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes. The late president and I were there. Then from there, I think an occasion arose for, there was a by-election in Chingola. And having come from the Kuba Belt, people asked me to go and stand in Chingola. And I had some businesses in Chingola, so I was quite well known there.
You are still well known.
Yeah, I see. Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
Yes, so I went to Chingola and stood for elections and was elected. I took over from Mr. Milner.
Aaron Milner.
Yes, Aaron Milner was the MP there. And there was a by-election. Because the other person had died, I think. So that's how I became a member of parliament for Chingola. Yes, and being member of parliament, of course, I was in parliament for a few years. And then I was brought into the UNIP Central Committee. MCCs, we were called. In those days, position of MCC was higher than that of cabinet minister in UNIPS. Ministers were answerable to the central committee. So there I was, and I served on several political committees of the central committee.
Yes, sir.
Like I was on the finance committee, I was on the youth committee, I was in disciplinary committee. I think I was in about six committees that I served.
Yes, sir.
And then, as they say, the rest is history. So I just came climbing up until I became vice president.
Yes, sir.
But when I became minister, I was minister of higher education, then Minister of Commerce, Trade and Industry, and Minister of Health, again taking over from late Michael Sata. He had been Minister for
Health.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So I became Minister of Health and served there. And then I became, later on, I should say, I was appointed or promoted to be Vice President. And that's how I became vice president to the late
Patrick Mwanawasa.
No.
Yeah.
Your namesake.
Oh, President Chiluba.
Yes, President Chiluba.
Yes, sir.
Yes, and after President Chiluba, again I continued to be vice president to Levi Mwanawasa.
Yes, sir.
Indeed. So basically, that is in a nutshell.
Yes, sir.
Yes, but we could go on for just that area of my being in politics. We could go on for a long time. But to cut a long story short, I don't know how much time we have, but...
We have enough time, sir.
Have we?
Because,
all right.
You know, what I've noticed, Your Honor.
Yes.
Zambia is one country.
Right.
That does not celebrate its heroes. And you find we have people like Brigadier General Mianda, a man with vast experience in the army.
Yes.
We have people like General Chinkuli.
Yes.
Peter Zuze.
Yes.
And all those generals.
Yeah, yeah.
In Zambia, once a general retires, they don't consult them. Once you become a commander of the army, you become a commander of the national service, inspector general of police, those who were before you, they become irrelevant because you are of the same rank. And I think some of the grave mistakes we make in the nation, we do not follow up with those who were before us.
Yes, you're very right. You're very right because, yes, that's something also I've noticed. People like to get into power and try to reinvent the wheel.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, if really they were interacted with those that had been there before, certain things would not happen. Because they happened and they were corrected. Yes. So for me, who has been, and several others, who have been more or less in all the governments, we can tell, say, but this thing they are doing, our friends now, this was corrected. We did this in UNIP, not even under President Chiluba, not even under Mwanawasa, but say in UNIP. Then from there, I'll say, but this we did when President Chiluba was there. You know, things like that, yes. So it's really a shame that there's no continuity in policy, as it were. Yes.
You know, there is a scripture in the Word of God, Honorable Kavendere. It says, he that goes into the battle should not laugh at somebody who is coming out of the battle.
No.
And I respect that scripture. And the moment I read of it for the first time, Baghdad came to my mind.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Or Iraq.
Yes, 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 yes.
Somebody who has served in Iraq as a soldier, even if he's a sergeant, once they survive those grounds and they go back to America or they go back to France, they should not... the people who are now going, taking over, should not look down on the people who have come out of battle because they've experienced, they've gone through, they know where the grenades are and all these things.
Yes.
You who is going into the battle for the first time, there are a lot of dangers that you may face.
Correct.
And so, looking at the nation of Zambia, sir, I am very passionate about this nation. Zambia is a great nation. And people like you, you are above political parties. This is just my thought. Please correct me if I'm wrong. Because having served as vice president twice, minister and what, I don't think you'd like to take partisan politics.
No, no, not really, no.
Yeah.
No. I certainly would not like to take partisan politics. I'd like to advise. But, you know, advice is just advice. It can be either accepted or rejected. But in my case, and in the case of many others also, that we've gone through these things, yes, and we certainly could advise. For instance, the question of foreign exchange in this country and the rate that has gone so much. You know, we had gone through things like that before. We discovered then that... a lot of money was leaving the country.
Was leaving the country?
Yes, yes. A lot of money was being taken away by the country. As you know, this economy of Zambia is basically controlled by foreigners. Yes, foreigners are in the majority here. Now, most of those foreigners in business who are in Zambia are not here because they like Zambia. Okay, they appreciate Zambia because Zambia is peaceful and things like that. But they are here to make a profit, to make a buck, which they'll send home. So certain measures were taken. For instance, children whose parents could afford to send them to school abroad were allowed to go. And foreign exchange was paid from Zambia for those children's fees. But there were controls. Yes. There were regulations. For instance, every term, in order to get money from the Bank of Zambia for education, school reports were demanded from parents who had children abroad. Yes. The idea was to protect foreign exchange, because there was nothing that could stop somebody from another country just print his own papers, this Chulumba
I'm
school
sending my son,
in Timbuktu,
yeah.
And and charging fees, and then Zambia continue.
Money is going.
Yeah, money goes. Yes, and so we discovered that was a problem. So the issue of school reports became very important. Yes, because every school had to issue a report. So Zambia knew then, or the Bank of Zambia knew, that as they sent the money, they were sending it to genuine schools. Yes. So those were the controls. It's not so now. Now, you know, money is sent without those regulations. So there's a lot of abuse when it comes to that.
Sir, I can attest to that because by the special grace of God, I have my daughter.
Right.
Who has been at the university in South Africa.
Correct.
And when we send the money, of course we fill in those forms.
Yes.
You send the money, you pay the school fees, and you do this. But there are no strict measures like in UNIP. At that time when we used to travel, they will even ask you to fill a lot of forms.
Yes.
To just allow that money to go out of the country.
Yes.
It was something else.
Indeed, at times it was overdone, but at least it controlled the outflow of foreign currency. Yes. And when I look back, I say, we complained at that time, but in actual fact, that was so necessary so that money from Zambia could not just be wasted. Indeed. So, and also, in those days, if you ever were to import anything from outside in Zambia, there was pre-shipment. That is, the supplier gave you an invoice. You took that invoice to your bank, and your bank opened a letter of credit. They didn't send the money just like it is now. They send the money and then. No, you had to go through a letter of credit. A letter of credit meant that banks here had correspondent arrangements with other banks abroad who would pay on your behalf to the supplier. But a lot of things had to match. What you ordered had to be inspected. Was the price correct? You know, things like that. So when we did things like that, it meant then you couldn't buy $1 million worth of
equipment.
Per vehicle, as an ambulance or firefighter, whatever. No, because that had to be inspected pre-shipment inspection. So it meant sure that you were getting what you had paid for. Yes. So there was no cheating, like overpricing. Because the companies that did pre-inspection were paid according to the quality of work that they did. So they would go and inspect the factory, yes, of the things that you had ordered. Make sure that those were the things that came. So they had to match with what you had ordered and what you were going to pay for. So only when they certified that everything was correct would they then be paid. And also, there was those letters of credit had tenures. It could not go on forever. It was, say, maybe 3 months. So if come 3 months, the items that you had ordered were not shipped to Zambia,
you forfeit.
Yeah, then, yes, they could not be paid.
Really?
They had to ask you, the importer, whether you agree to extend the letter of credit.
Mm.
What I'm trying to say is that in that manner, foreign exchange of Zambia was protected.
Mm.
I read now the Auditor General's report, this department paid for drenchers, $9 million. The drenchers haven't come to Zambia past the 4 years, 5 years. Those things would not happen with the regulations we put in.
Mm.
It wasn't really exchange control as such, but it was regulated.
No, what you are saying, sir, this is making sense. You know, being a pastor.
Yes.
About 2-3 years ago.
Right.
We ordered a compressor.
Right.
A big compressor.
Correct.
And from one country, let me keep withheld the country for security reasons.
Correct.
And then this supplier asked me a question and said, look, Reverend, this, apparently they are Buddhists, this compressor was costing 9,800 then, about 3 years ago.
Right.
Yeah. $9,800. Then he says, I know that it's going to cost you when it comes to your country. We receive a lot of people from your country. So can I write the invoice for $3,000? And then I will know what to do when shipping here. I'll put that.
Mm.
So now you can imagine a challenge. Me as a pastor, I should accept to the proposal that I pay for the compressor for $3,000 so that I can escape duty. I said, no. Do you understand who is a reverend?
Mm.
He said, no. I said, I'm in the church, I'm in the temple. There is no way I can bring the price down. But to say the least, Your Honor, I sent the money. Bank of Zambia did not ask me.
Mm.
And I know I'm not the only one. There are a lot of people who send the money like this. We are sleeping with the door open, actually, in terms of foreign exchange.
Oh, yes.
Because people are taking the money out of this country. What you have brought, sir, it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, and these things, we talk to our friends who came in and they said, look, these are some of the things you have to be careful about and things like that. But unfortunately, payments from Zambia just go. Now they go within a day.
Mm.
Yeah, so if you go to the bank at 9 hours, you want to remit money for whatever. By 15 hours, the money is... Would have
whether goods are there or not, whether it's fake or not.
No, doesn't matter. And people will go there and get the money at the other end.
Mm.
So these are things that I think need to be looked at in terms of foreign exchange. But with respect to government, in the year 2012... The Bank of Zambia came up, and I must say the Ministry of Finance, working with the Bank of Zambia, came up with a statutory instrument called 33.
Mm.
Yes. Statutory instrument 33 was there to protect the kwacha.
Mm.
So the currency of Zambia is the kwacha. So don't start dealing now, paying rent and whatever in dollars.
Yeah.
So those things like that have made it very difficult to control the exchange rate.
Mm.
Because everyone now wants dollars.
Mm.
Yes, wants dollars. Even outside the church here, we laughed the other day. I was passing through and there were some women selling mangoes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I said, why are the mangoes so expensive? I think I get $1. The dollar, how come dollar?
Mango from Rufunsa.
Yes. But I realized that, yes, maybe there are costs involved. Yeah, in dollars, maybe.
No, sir.
Indeed. So,
the other times I was also buying this cobweb remover from just a street person.
Yes.
I wanted to help them by buying those cobweb removers.
Mm.
And he inflated the price. I said, why? He says, Pastor, you know, this sisal comes from Tanzania.
Oh.
The dye comes from South Africa. So there is a lot of foreign exchange involved.
Only
this stick. Mm. And he's pricing things in dollars. I know he was joking, but everyone is saying dollar.
Yeah, that's right. So,
yeah,
a state instrument was made that the currency of Zambia is kwacha.
Mm.
Even if you have dollars, you bring your dollars, you have to change them into kwacha and spend kwacha, not dollars and things like that. And things started to stabilize.
Mm.
We were very happy. The statutory instrument, the regulation was there.
Mm.
So, in no time, it was removed in 2012.
Mm.
Yeah, so we've never understood why it was removed, because we would not be where we are now.
Mm.
21 kwacha.
21.4.
Yeah, 0.4. Mm. Soon it will be 22 and 25. If that law had not been reversed. Yeah. So I really fail to understand why that was reversed.
Mm.
Again, another statutory instrument, I think it's 55.
May I ask your honor?
Yes.
At what point, because I know that even during President Chiluba's administration, in UNIPID time, you had those TIFA laws that I remember buying Coca-Cola from duty-free shop.
Oh, yes.
And I was stopped by CITET. Where did you get this?
Where did you get it?
And I produced the receipt and the exchange slip from West Indies when I came with dollars. CITET stopped me. Coca-Cola.
Yeah.
But when my namesake, may so rest in peace, when democracy and liberalization came, is that where we lost it, or?
No.
In terms of dollar?
Well, there were still some controls.
Mm.
Of course, they would not hold you for having 10 kwacha, 50 kwacha, or something like that. Yes. There were some controls, but those from UNIP were a little bit too strict.
Mm.
Yes, you had to, if you had some dollars, you had to put them in your shoe.
I remember that. Yes, sir. You can't declare everything.
Yeah, things like that. Yeah. Indeed. But that wasn't very bad at all. What I'm talking about is now the wanton dollarization of the currency of Zambia.
Mm.
Yes, that has caused problems. There are many other reasons, and I'll give you, subject to time, I'll give you some of the reasons that are making this whole thing unattainable.
Mm.
The demand for foreign currency is very high compared to, you know, what is coming in.
Mm.
What in UNIP, I recall very well, my committee came up with some suggestion which was implemented that, okay, if you made your own foreign exchange from your businesses or whatever, you could spend it, okay?
If you made it in this country?
Yes, this country.
Mm.
Yes. This is how Lonro went to Mumbwa and set up that ginary.
Mm.
Yes. So they set up the ginary, they would buy cotton from the villagers around there, gin the cotton, export it.
Mm.
And from the exports of cotton, they would support their other companies, such as the one that was selling Mercedes-Benz, Star Motors, spare parts, things like that. From the foreign exchange that they themselves created. Yes, it's no longer the case.
Mm.
Yeah, no longer the case. Anyone can now go into their bank and get as much foreign exchange as is the bank would allow them to do. So again, things like that. Yeah.
May I ask your honor?
Yes.
What you are bringing to the nation, and the nation should look at this very critically, and the problem again that we have in Zambia is that when somebody is bringing issues, we label him as an enemy or a cartel or enemy of progress. But we should learn from those that were before us. Even the Bible talks about that.
Yeah.
Your honor, sir, what you are saying, I'm relating. I have a friend. I have many friends in South Africa. You know, is a businessman.
Yes.
He brought something for sale here. And he sold certain things and got the dollar.
Yep.
I think it was about $25,000. He changed in no time.
Yeah, yeah.
When
yeah.
we met in Santon, and he says, you know, Zambia is a great country.
Yes.
Here in South Africa, ooh, you can't get $1,000
no.
out of the economy.
No.
I was in your country, $25,000. I am so happy. Now I am thinking, Your Honor, who is in charge? Can the president just direct and say no more foreign control? Or is it the Bank of Zambia or is the minister? Who is responsible for this kind of...
Well, to be fair to the president, he's got his ministers, he's got the central bank. But these are the people who actually came up with this statutory instrument.
Mm.
Yes. Forbidding the misuse of foreign exchange.
The ministers.
Yes, yes, yes. The law is there. It's called the statutory instrument 33.
Mm.
It's there. But just to a call to the ministers, that thing was reversed. This was in the 2011, 2012, when it was signed. So a few months later, it was reversed. Now, that wasn't it wasn't too bad. But I can tell you what is terrible is there was yet another statutory instrument, I think 55 or so, which stated that if you came into Zambia with any currency or you started a business, fine, you were welcome. But you had to inform the Bank of Zambia where you got the money from.
Mm.
Yes, abroad.
Like those forms we declare to the
airport.
And yeah.
Because you're going to pay back. In fact, Zambia is going to pay back. So Zambia should know how much money you've borrowed outside and what interest you're paying. There was one company, I think, here. Not I think, but there was one company. They borrowed from their parent company. You know, normally when you borrow from your parent company or another company, the rates are very low.
Mm.
These were paying 34% interest, yes, on the money borrowed, which was really a big ripoff.
Mm.
Yes, that stealing, more or less, say stealing money from Zambia.
Mm.
Yes, even that was again reversed. Yes, but that was there to protect the integrity of
the kwacha. Yeah.
And the dollars. And that, so you would not go to any country with just walking even with billions and they don't ask you.
Mm.
They would ask you because, in fact, if you have borrowed that money, you have to pay it back at some point.
Mm.
And because they won't pay it at some point, they needed to know, the authorities needed to know.
Mm.
So, that again, I'm still baffled. I wrote a letter to the minister then. I said, Minister, how could you be bullied? You know, you had come up with a very good law which will make, stabilize more or less
the
our kwacha.
Mm.
Yes, yeah. But, you know, people, that still remained unreversed. Then the last one I didn't like was that government had come up that we should all be paying direct tax on imports as opposed to VAT.
VAT.
Yeah, yeah. For me, I liked that. And the reason I liked that was, look, VAT, people claiming back was a problem. And also, they're very big importers, like the mines.
Mm.
Don't buy from factories.
Mm.
The mines buy from their own companies abroad.
I know that.
Okay? Even ZCCM, to that effect, had a business in Ashford, Kent.
Mm.
Yes, which was a buying office, indeed. So that, again, needed to be supported there with the, you know, all sorts of overheads, whatever.
Mm.
But if there was a pre-inspection, they would not do anything at all. But because the companies buy in order to sell to their companies in Zambia, what happens is that there's nothing to stop them overloading the price
inflating
of things they bought.
Inflating their prices,
yeah.
Yes.
Because when those things come here, they are required to pay VAT, which they claim back.
Mm.
Yeah. So there's no problem at all. You know, because they can charge any amount to Zambia and pay VAT and ask for to be refunded VAT.
Mm. Mm.
So it's really a very big scam. But again, government got it right. They said, no. We think that they should just pay direct tax. Because with the direct tax, they cannot inflate.
They can't.
No, they cannot. Because they are selling, they are buying, and they want to use that equipment. So they have to pay tax in order to get that equipment. Mm. It ends there.
Yeah.
So I don't know how much our government would have paid to these mines in forms of refunds, VAT refunds, which are not really refunds as such, because these people are buying from their own buying offices abroad.
Mm.
Yes. But with what we had in UNIP, the pre-inspection, things like that would not happen.
Mm.
Because the companies that were employed to pre-inspect your shipments to Zambia would go to where maybe trucks were manufactured or bulldozers and get the pricing, correct pricing.
Mm.
And there's no way they could, talk them into inflating.
Mm.
Yeah, yeah. So those are some of the things that, and what happens in our countries that there are some of our people, very learned, very qualified. Whenever their government tries to correct a thing, they come, some even live abroad, they fly into Zambia to talk to the powers that be.
Mm.
Yes, 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 to have these things reversed, which is really a shame. Which is a shame.
Your Honor, I must agree with you. I'm not an economist.
No.
But I was at pain when I learned that the government of Zambia won't go ahead with a direct tax.
Mm.
Because one of the most qualified economists Zambia's raised is in Canada, and another one in the UK.
Mm.
When the government started talking about tax, in fact, this gentleman is a Zambian.
Yes, I know.
He was called to be, he could have gone as the bank of bank governor of Jamaica, because he's married a lady from there.
Right.
Very highly qualified. But when he heard the government talking about direct tax, he gave me a call. And he said, Pastor Chuba, our economy will boom.
Yep.
Because this nonsense of VAT, people are stealing through this same
code
VAT.
He was very correct.
If you introduce, as the government introduces the direct tax, the people will know now. And one of the things that he said, Your Honor, I've never forgotten. He said this thing won't go anywhere because the people who benefit, who control the forces and the markets out there, won't allow our government to go through with this.
Yes.
And before long, I saw that it was shut down.
Yes.
That no tax, only VAT.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The lobbyists, they are people, Zambian people, who when Zambia wants to correct its situation, whatever, they fly in, those who live abroad.
Mm.
And even those who are here are hired by these big multinationals in order to lobby their government against the corrective measures that their government would have wanted to take, which is really a shame that people are able, out of greed, to support foreigners, take money out of Zambia. And that's happening all the time. So I'm hoping that government in the next budget has to re-look at this VAT situation. Yes, VAT, maybe there could be two systems. Okay, you and I must pay VAT, fair enough. Then those very big importers must
pay tax,
direct tax. Yes, because I don't know how much money the government is paying in refunds, which is not really genuine refunds at all. Yes. But these things are known. But the problem is that, on the other hand, the lobbyists, the Zambian people who come to lobby on behalf of multinationals, are well paid and well connected. Yes, they've got the right people, indeed. Because certainly the decision to bar the use of kwacha in all transactions came as a complete surprise. For it was so well done. Bank of Zambia and the ministry, I think, or whoever, did not say that you don't bring in foreign exchange. They said you can bring in your foreign exchange. However, when you want to buy anything within Zambia, please use kwacha. Go to a bureau de change, go to a commercial bank, change your, convert your dollars into kwacha. So let's all use kwacha. But just for the convenience, of very few people, you know, because it's just convenience, really. They're not stopping you from buying anything at all. But for the benefit of very few people, they pay in dollars, so everyone now starts copying and paying in dollars.
Your Honor, may I ask you this question?
Yes.
Being a patriotic Zambian, like I said, I know you are above politics. You cannot side with MMD, UPND, you cannot side with PF. The fact that you have saved as number two in this nation puts you at a level where you look at this country as your own. And you cannot side, whoever is there. And when things are wrong, they are wrong. There are certain things, like you are saying, Your Honor, in Kaunda government, I remember this very well, because it was just a known fact. You would not have an accountant coming from Britain to work as an accountant here. The first thing was, is there no Zambian who qualifies? I think you had such laws there.
Yes, yes, yes.
Where you cannot just bring anyone, as long as he's in Zambia, they start working. When there was a Zambian with a similar qualification with a foreigner, you picked a Zambian. That was one way of controlling, I think, also the kwacha, the currency. Now, we have a lot of foreigners who are doing things which are irrelevant, which Zambians can do.
Correct.
And they are being paid in huge, humongous figures. What would you say to that? Where have we lost it, Honorable?
Well, certainly, expatriates are here, employed here, to train at times, to train local people. And after staying for 2-3 years, they go back. And that way, then a local person takes over. But when it comes to expatriates, even the UK has expatriates. For even some Zambians, we work in England, and they are employed there. True, they are also British people who are qualified. But so you cannot really close off a situation where you say that no, only our local people should do this, should do that. But what it is that every situation needs to be regulated. Yes, we need to be regulated. There are people here from diaspora or even foreigners who, when they start up a business here, they bring their cousins, they bring their nephews, they bring their, you know, their people to set up a business. We see them all the time, all the time. Now, I think that is not, that's not correct. The issue of Zambianization, which I, as far as I know, the policy is still there, should be reinforced. So, but this country, which does not make much foreign exchange at all, can survive. Here, the mines are owned by foreigners. We only own 20%, whatever. Our only benefit there is when they pay salaries to our local people, then our people pay tax. But otherwise, all the money goes. In the Congo, DRC, these mines are required to, well, when they mine and sell, they are required to bring 60% of the sales volume back to the Congo.
Is that so?
Yes, even for 3 days.
In DRC?
DRC here. In fact, as I'm talking to you, there is some disagreement between a company that is mining in Northwestern Province, which also mines in the mining gold in the Congo. They're arguing over 500 million. And the Congolese government, as far as I know, have won.
Really?
Yes, I don't know. The money belongs to Congo. Same thing with Tanzania. Yes, that same company is also in Tanzania. Then Tanzania, they just gave them a bill. So there you are. We want you to pay $3 billion in tax, which we think you owe. Thank you. If you don't want...
My goodness.
Bye. You can go home. But you're not going to take the gold or whatever that is mined already here. So these things really require patriots, not, you know, people who can be bought out easily, who can defend people who want to strangle your economy. And there are very many local people, people who are in the employ of government, of the private sector, to lobby their own government, to defeat their own government.
Your Honor, may I ask you this from my heart?
Yes, Pastor.
Zambia being a blessing to my heart, I'm a pastor. My wife and I, by the grace of God, we are doing what we can, and thank God for the government who gave us the license.
Yes.
And our president to allow us operate.
Indeed.
As a station. Good. Because in other countries, they can just shut you up without remorse.
Oh, yeah.
But we are grateful to this government. Now, my question, Your Honor, is, do you speak to President Edgar Chagwalungu? Do you have times when you, General Myanda, Dr. Nevas Mumba, you put this politics aside? Because the failure of President Chagwalungu is your failure.
That's true.
It is our failure.
That's true.
So we should not just leave it to people like the cabinet ministers, those who are just directing the affairs. And No. There are people like yourself.
Yes.
There are people in this nation that can help our president. Do you talk to him? Do you have moments of calling him and you chat?
Well, certainly he has my number. I have his number. And when one or two things have happened, we've brought it to his attention. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I could talk to the president direct, but the president is not the one who issues VAT forms or whatever. Mm. So he will tell somebody else. Now that's somebody else. Government works in a very funny way. You can get the top man, that's the president, giving instructions.
Yeah.
And those instructions will go to a minister, go to a PS, go to a director, and just one clerk sits on them, and that's it.
Really?
You've had it. Yes, that, unfortunately, that is how government works. So every president wants to succeed, wants to be successful. Indeed. So president is doing his best. But for me, because I've had long experience, I do know where the failure is in doing certain things. Yes. There are people basically paid to defeat the government policies.
Really?
And there are many. Yes, there are many.
Even in this country?
Yes. Even in this country. You would tell, because I think the statutory instrument I'm talking about,
yes, sir,
was signed by his minister. So, for me, I do know that it must have been discussed at cabinet.
Yes, sir.
And obviously, the president is chairman of cabinet. So, he could have put in a word and then allowed the minister to sign. For that is how it came to be a statutory instrument. But in between minister signing and no implementation, lobbyists came in. Yes. And defeated government policy. In the process, a lot of money is lost.
Sir, that in my own trade as a pastor, in my own profession, it's called witchcraft.
Yeah.
Whoever is bewitching the ministers, whoever is bewitching government, there is no way. And why I'm saying, sir, if you call on the president, we need to have this dialogue. It's necessary. You know, it's easy to criticize the president. It's easy to criticize the cabinet.
Right.
But look at what you are doing, Your Honor, here. You are giving free advice to the people of Zambia, to the minister. I hope Honorable Ngandu Magande is listening. Because
Walyangandu,
is listening to this discussion and some ministers out there. Because it is very important, sir, you were vice president. Which year was that, sir, when you first became vice president?
2001, I think, yes.
2001, you were vice president.
Yes.
And you saved Before that, you were a cabinet minister.
Yes, I was.
And after that, you were still vice president in Levi Mwanawasa's government.
Correct.
Today, you are not there.
Mm.
And what we forget is that once I'm in this seat, I will never be there again. Mm. I will never be there sometime. And what I do between now and my time in that office will either put Zambia at an awkward position or it will rectify things.
Correct.
So what I'm saying, sir, there are a lot of critics who criticize for the sake of criticizing.
Mm.
And sometimes you tend to think that opposition parties is about opposing what the government is doing. But if we came together, opposition, yourselves, and the president, we say, Vane, politics aside, things have gone wrong. Let's look at the measures to control the kwacha and the dollar. That has nothing to do with politics, Your Honor.
No, it has nothing to do with the politics, and certainly if you see the thing really as a way I look at it, we have very clever young people who've come up in association of this and that and that, but they haven't really had the other the experiences that some of us have had.
That's right.
Because we tried it and it failed. We went elsewhere, we tried this and indeed. So we would like to assist them. We don't want them to come and say we are interfering in their work. But certainly we have that experience. There are many people who are in the MMD who I think are extremely good, who are in UNIP. So of course, many of them are aged now, but they have a lot of knowledge that they could pass on. Yes. More so, you know, it beats like beats me to think that only a few years ago, maybe before, if not 2017, the exchange rate was 9 kwacha 8 ngwe to a dollar. Now it's 21.40. All within 3 years. But there's something that needs to be done. And we do know what needs to be done. Yes. However, maybe we're not given the opportunity. We are not given the opportunity. We don't want to appear, you know, to be interfering. But I think we could sit down and just advise that when we were faced with a problem like this, this is how we resolved it. Like I've given you the example of Lonro, starting that Mumbu Ajinari.
Yes, sir.
Yes, because there was no foreign exchange, but they wanted foreign exchange for spare parts. So I said, but we don't have the money. Where would the money come from? So we devised a way that, yes, you create your own money, and you can use it. And indeed, they created their own money, and they bought the spare parts they needed. Their companies expanded and things like that. But now, you don't have, there are times when you don't have companies that are making their own money, but they are busy
dipping into the pocket,
yes,
and taking the money.
Yes, into the little that there is, which is a shame.
Your Honor, I'm sure my director will prepare me the clip which was carried out on the news on Camnet TV this evening.
Okay.
And it brought sad reading and hearing, I should say. Do you think there is hope for us to rectify these issues, beginning with the foreign exchange? Do you think we can arrest it?
Yes. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. And just by starting the two laws, so to speak, the two statutory instruments that they reversed would have helped us arrest the situation as is.
So would you know, Your Honor, why they reversed it? Is it to keep the investors, or what it is, or what is it, or is it because of what you are calling international lobbyists who come to try and make the government fail?
When I made my own inquiries, because I was very disappointed, I was informed that investors will not come to Zambia if you ask them where the money has come from, or if you ask them to fill in forms, or if you do. I said, nonsense. It can't be like that. Which serious investor will not come to Zambia because he's been asked to account for his money? You know, things like that. But because that too many powerful lobbyists. So I would like to see the day that I've written two papers on this subject. Yes, and I'd like to discuss it with the government at some point. So that's the only thing that will reverse the trend. Otherwise, come next year, this dollar kwacha will be about $35 to $35 kwacha to a dollar.
So are you saying, Your Honor, are you saying that because of not asking where you got the money from, even drug dealers can find an occasion to bring in the money?
But even if drug dealers brought in the money, they would not bring it here to invest. No. They just maybe buy drugs and go back and make more money elsewhere. But what we want as no serious investor would abandon their project because they've been asked to
declare
fill in forms.
Them. Yeah.
No. So we have to start correcting those primary issues before we get to serious issues.
Well, dear Comnet TV viewers, in the studio, I am with His Honor, the former Vice President of the Republic of Zambia, Mr. Enoch Kavindele, who saved immediately after the UNIPI government one-party system. He served under President Chiluba, may he so rest in peace. He also went in and saved under President Levi Mwanawasa, may he so rest in peace. With that vast knowledge, like you are hearing, surely we learn from those that have gone before us. I have been a pastor since 1984. If you put the 2 years in Bible college, which is 1982 to now, I have seen certain pitfalls. I have seen certain things that as a pastor, somebody graduating from Bible college, even if you have a PhD, you may not have the experience that I've had in the ministry as a pastor. With your doctorate degree, certain things you need to confer and say, Pastor Chiluba, how have you first survived this? What makes you tick? I think that I look forward, Your Honor, to a time when Zambia, somebody becomes president, he will say, where is Honorable Kavindele? Where is Honorable Mianda, Nevas Mumba, and all of you that have been there? Where is former Minister of Finance? Whether they are in this party or on this party, let's come together. How do we solve this problem? It's a national problem, and we need to solve it. I look forward to that time, sir.
Well, certainly, Pastor Chiluba, that is how it's supposed to be. That's how it's supposed to be. I noticed today, as I was watching TV, a new president of America has brought in former ministers in the other government of
Bill Clinton, Donald Trump.
No.
The new president of America,
yes,
Biden.
Yes, Biden.
Yeah,
he's appointed to his cabinet people that were in, I think, Clinton's government.
Oh, okay.
Yes. I'm not saying that I want a job in government, but certainly I have a lot of experience to assist people. Talked about a clip, yeah.
Yeah, let me see if my director is ready to give us a clip. This, Your Honor, happened today, and it was covered on Comnet TV News. Mr. Director, give me that clip for the people who have been displaced.
Twakaka is a Lenja word meaning we have refused. These are the village men and women of Leteta area in Chibombo district resisting the alleged development from the Chinese nationals that have come to occupy the land without due consideration of displacing the actual occupants. In Leteta area, it is alleged that 8,000 hectares of land has been given to the Chinese nationals by the traditional leadership in the area. The land in question is said to have over 10,000 people from 12 headmen. In simple terms, if they are left to go ahead and take the land away from the local people, over 10,000 people will be displaced from the only place they call home. Zambia recognizes two types of land tenure, which is customary and leasehold tenure. Historically, the majority of land in Zambia has been held under customary tenure. Customary land is protected by traditional leaders, otherwise known as chiefs. Traditional leaders can only give land up to slightly above 250 hectares. While this may be true, the case is different for Litata.
Problem they have.
Ngamacha inake sa.
Chinese have come.
Baka panga mapu.
They made their map.
Bakenjira kwarokunganda yangu bakenjisha mukati ashumbo shabata shose shakenjira mukati.
At his home they even entered in the funeral or leopard graveyard.
Onopa kwamba itwambe mamitinya kafura payane mbobagesamba abapolisi amafuti.
When they were complaining, people were Chinese came with the police.
They
came with police and they were with guns. Then him, he forced himself that even if you want to shoot me, shoot me.
Clearly, no one is happy about this alleged development in the area. They are since calling on government to help them save the land they have called home for their lifetime.
We are there at the meeting at school.
Swako twakanyamuka watu meeting ndia kawa wakamba 24 antarasha wakali kwamba 24 antarasha mbavaninga wali kwamba 24 no bantu namutoka kana mutosumina.
When they came, the Indians, Mr. Council Chairman Ntarasha of Chibombo said, if you are agreeing, we are hearing from you.
Muba manene manene wakunembo mbuliva DC. Wamu Chibombo District, alimwa wa Council Chairman Chibombo District, alimwa wa Chief Vesuvaiteta.
They took those places through our Council Chairman, our Chief and DC.
Efforts to get a comment from Chief Litata could not materialize. What is left is whether the Ministry of Lands will take it up or not, knowing that traditional land is vested in traditional leaders. For now, we can only hope that the matter will be sorted out amicably. Sharon Kalimbula, Kamnet News, Lusaka.
Your Honor,
yes,
have you heard this problem?
Pastor, yes, I have, and it's very sad, it's very sad. But I am aware, though, that the government of Zambia has demarcated 100,000 hectares in each of the 10 provinces for development of large-scale farms, including the corridor, the Mpika Serenge,
yes, sir.
Yeah, corridor. And that is where people seeking such large tracts of land are meant to go to. They are not meant to displace people like we've just heard, but it's very, very sad. So, Yes, these villages that Chiwombo is quite close to Lusaka. Yes, and I think government should explore more the very good policy that they have of developing those 100,000 hectares each province has. Yes, because when you now go to Sonia Lusaka and displace 8,000 people,
10,000.
10,000. Where do they go to?
Mm.
Yes, where do they go to?
Your Honor, when I listened to the news this evening, and it just made my heart heavy. It seems that sometimes we don't learn. The problem that Zimbabwe encountered, the problem that South Africa is talking about, appropriation of land without compensation, if we are not careful, it will come to Zambia. It may come to Zambia in that, how do you empower people? Here we are, Your Honor. My wife and I have begun a program of farming, and we want to help the government. I'm a Zambian. We've got Jewish people, we've got Egyptians, we've got people from different countries who want to help this nation with agriculture. But what I've said with my wife is that if you have land, don't change the title deeds to Pastor Chiluba or Cabinet TV. Keep it as your land. Just invite us to come and develop the area with you. After 5 years, 10 years, we've developed it, 20 center pivots, 10 center pivots, it will still be your land. And that money, Your Honor, will remain in Zambia. I sat down with my calculator and I started looking at what 6,000 hectares can do, even for me as a Zambian. Ooh. Your Honor, there is no way I can fail to produce less than $2 billion as a Zambian, because now our eyes are opened. So how do you allow, especially the headmen or the chiefs, I don't know, how do you allow somebody to take 6,000 hectares?
Yeah, I think there's an issue there. For all I know, chiefs and headmen can only give up to 250 hectares.
Absolutely.
So anything above that has got the Commission of Lands, and then who will sign it on behalf of the president. Yes, so I don't know what's happened to the people there, but like I've said before, government, you know, has a lot of land meant for agriculture. And I think this is where they should be sending anyone wanting more than 250 hectares. Yes, in Western Province, I think in Kaoma, there's that land in Solwezi, Chief Mjimanzovu and Senior Chief Kalilele. They've got that type of land. And so I think, in fairness, because our people take advantage of the fact that our people don't have the money to develop such huge hectares of land. So if they develop them, then they will employ them. But all the same, you know, Zambia is not ending tomorrow. Zambia will be there, hopefully, in 1,000 years or so. Now, when you give away that amount of land, where will the children that are being born go to? So that is...
Your Honor, let me take you back before we start receiving phone calls. Let me take you to the issue of Northwestern Province. That's where my former Vice President comes from.
Yes.
Why is it that with abundant resources of minerals, Mukula tree, and why is Northwestern Province backward in terms of development?
To be honest with you, you are very right, Pastor. Northwestern has almost everything that you can think of. I was in the village 2 months ago, and the trees that are found that have been cut down by foreigners there, and the big trucks that are there to bring that the felled trees to the line of rail. It's really very, very shocking. But most of our people lack capital. There's no one to provide them with the capital in order to enter into these things. So the people with money are taking advantage of the poverty levels that are there. And
do they cut trees with the consent, with the consent of the government, or it's illegal, or it's just free for all? If I've got money today, can I go to Sulawesi and cut trees?
When I asked, they said, yeah, what happens that people come from Lusaka with pieces of paper saying, this is my license, who and who are you to stop me? I've already got a license to cut trees. And when I talk about trees, huge trees that have been around there for about 100 years, you know, huge trees indeed, yes, but they are not themselves getting anything at all.
They are not benefiting.
No, they're not benefiting at all, because firstly, the people that go to cut these trees go with chainsaws. Yes, so just 5 minutes, a whole tree that has been standing for 100 years.
Sit down.
Yes, 5 minutes down, start cutting it, loading it onto trucks from line of rail.
And that they are cutting every day.
Every day, every day. At Kabumpo Boma, I was totally shocked. I was totally shocked. The amount of trucks that I saw there, with laden with a special wood called rosewood. Yeah, which is even, I think, much more valuable than a mukula tree. Yeah. It couldn't have been less than 16 vehicles.
16 trucks.
16 trucks, all laden with the timber coming out. Yes. It's really, it is a shame. It is a shame.
It is very saddening. Very, very saddening, to say the least.
Yeah.
I can only appeal to our mother, Madam Jean Kapata. She's the Minister of Lands, right?
Yes.
She's the Minister of Lands. When people are crying, when these things are going on, please issue a statement. Make a statement that you know, if you know, how much is Zambia benefiting from those trees? Because I loved what you said, Your Honor. Foreigners don't come to Zambia because they love Zambia. They come to Zambia to make money.
Correct.
And if we are deceived to think this is an investor, this person has come to improve Zambia, we are joking. And it's high time Zambia looked at all these things critically. And when we speak, Honorable Kavendere, I've been a preacher under your leadership. You know how I talk. The problem I've committed in this nation, I don't go round. You know, I just talk as it is. And even from the time before you became Vice President, Your Honor, you remember in Kaunda time, MMD accused me of being on the side of Kaunda? If you remember that telecast did. But it's because I'm a Zambian. I've got nowhere to go. Now, if those trees, which have been standing for 100 years, and somebody comes with chainsaws, and they are taking them, 16, 17 trucks, where is the money going? Who is accounting for that? You know, this is where we need information. This is where we need information. If you tell me, or the government tells me, or Pastor Chiluba, for 16 trucks, Zambia's benefited $5 million, my heart will be at peace. Not correct. Just seeing trucks going, trucks coming and trucks going. I think we need to do a stock taking in every area.
Oh, yes, oh, yes. No, it's really very sad. The amount of trucks that carry mukula tree and... Because, you know, we didn't even know the value of mukula tree ourselves. Yeah, until the Chinese came. Yes, yes, yes. These things were just growing and no one bothered about them. Because first of all, you could not cut them down for charcoal because they don't burn easily. Yeah, so we were just left to grow and grow and grow. But it's just the chainsaw, one day, 5 minutes, trees down. Very sad.
Your Honor,
yes, sir.
I'm going to open up the lines.
Oh.
I want us to discuss as Zambians. You provided us with a law of citizens' arrest. There is a law. I'm not a lawyer, yes. Again.
Yes.
But if I find somebody is committing crimes, I can arrest him.
Yes.
There is that law.
Yes, there is.
So does this law extend to my stopping the trucks if I sense that here there is no certificate or license?
To be honest with you, it should. I almost stopped. In fact, I stopped one truck driver there. And as I was talking to him, somebody came, who looked like Lebanese to me, said, no, this one has stolen my timber. I said, what do you mean? He says, no, I'm the one with the license, but these chaps were loading last night, and now he's taking the timber to Lusaka and things like that. But I think really they should be stopped.
Mm.
Yes, whether, because if you're a citizen, you arrest them, when you leave, they drive off.
I must say that it is sad what is happening. One of the days, sorry to say this, I was being phoned by some truck drivers who were loading some mukula tree or some trees in Northern Province, and they said, Pastor, these people have got no license. We have only been promised drivers. 5,000 kwacha, number 2 alishavana. If you find tobacco with license, they provided me with all the number plates, which I forwarded to some people to say, please check these trucks. They are now coming to Kapiri. They are now in Lusaka. Until they left at Chirundu, nothing was done. Mm. And such things, you begin to wonder, what is going on in this nation? And you know, there is the president. He's got his own problems. Is wanting to solve the issues and all this, like you said, that the government works in a very funny way. Because maybe just some director there or somebody who issues a license to Pastor Chuba, go and cut the trees, and I take them without the powers knowing. I think this is very annoying.
It is annoying, but that's really how things work. At times the top people don't know what's happening.
Let's take up this call, Your Honor.
Yes. Sir.
Hello, good evening.
Hello, Pastor Chief.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, thank you. I'm calling you from Livingstone.
Who?
Kariata. Calling you from Livingstone.
Mr. Kariata?
Kariata.
Ka?
Kariata.
Kariata.
Yes, Pastor.
Please speak to the nation.
Thank you so very much for the call given. Are you able to get to?
Yes, we are hearing you.
Yeah, I'm saying I'm going to speak to you on this platform.
Yes, sir.
I want to comment on this that just goes on the news way about the people crying for the land and other things.
I think raise your voice a bit. You are a bit faint.
I'm a bit faint?
Uh-huh. Yes, sir.
How about you?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah, I'm saying I want to comment on the issue of people crying for the land.
Uh-huh. People getting the land.
The moment I watched that on the telecast on the news, I felt very bad for the Zambia at one time.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad that you brought the Honorable Karindele and the senior student of the nation.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they're going to blame Tony with our Minister of Land, the Minister of Justice, to come in and help with our suffering that is the case. I personally can find Sanya one in my own land before the country of the king of the world.
Sorry, sir. Mr. Kayata, sorry. Are you getting what you say?
Not really.
Sorry, Mr. Kayata. Maybe drop the line and call us back again. I know you are contributing about the land and how sad you feel about the news clip. You listen to the news. But please call again and let God bless us. Dear Cabinet TV viewers, you can catch us on Facebook, you can catch us on YouTube, you can catch us on Zoom, you can catch us on whatever it is, but make sure that on Cabinet TV, Mr. Director, even the ID for Zoom and everything, please give it to the people. This is our nation, and this is national matters. We should be able to work together. I know that the president is not an angel. He makes mistakes. But when he makes mistakes, or when I make mistakes, the best way is not to rub it on me that I'm making these mistakes. I think the whole purpose is to help. And this is why His Honor, the former vice president, a man that has served as minister in different portfolios twice as vice president. May the Lord bless you, sir.
Thank you very much, Pastor.
Hello.
Hello.
Good evening, sir. Hello?
Hello?
What's your name, sir? Mr. Who?
Mr. Nsefu,
yeah.
From where?
From Chingola.
Chingola. Please go ahead and contribute to the nation of Zambia.
Yes. That's my suggestion. Yes. Hello?
Yes, sir? Sorry, sir. Mr. Nsefu. Mr. Nsefu. On your honor, were you getting something?
No. You talked about Chingola.
Yeah.
You talked about poverty. Yes, and I think that was all good here.
Maybe please, some of you, just write us a text or give us your contribution on. We are hardly hearing, and if we can't hear with His Honor here, I know you people that are listening and watching this broadcast, it's even worse. We are struggling to hear. Mr. Director, there are some text messages. Those of you who are writing text messages, please use the number on the middle there, 0962965883. You can also use it for WhatsApp. If you are to ask questions, here is our Father, who has saved this nation at different levels. And these people, in the corporate world or the market world there, they are called consultants. And Zambia, you need to glean from the wisdom of these people. Hello, good evening.
Hello, good evening.
Hello?
Hello, good evening.
Good evening, sir. What's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is...
You are who?
Malanji.
Malanji.
Yes, Pastor.
Please go ahead and contribute.
Good evening, Mr. Malanji.
Thank you, sir. I'm happy to mention here that my former father is a quite great man.
Is your former what?
He's my former boss.
Your former boss?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
And that one appreciates the advent when I was making to you. And I also want to appreciate you for the true of the great people. I'm just important because the people that you bring on this program, they really just think that it's without the people, they can put into poverty at a different level. Only because he is a man that has a passion for the country. If this is the important thing, even in background, And I wanted to see the mafia. I'm trying to help you and help me and come and see
you. Yes, sir.
Thank you so much for that. I'm ready for that.
Thank you, Mr. Malanji.
Thank you so much.
He's appreciating your hard work and how you saved it.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Your Somebody honor. Was telling me that you people saved and, you know, you didn't steal. And I was with another minister who said, even if he wanted to steal, there was nothing to steal. You know, we ran what was known as a cash budget.
Yeah.
Money had to be in the bank. Mm. Before it could be spent.
Mm.
Yes.
No, Your Honor, this country, I have great respect for all of you leaders.
Thank you.
And this is why I'm saying, please join hands with President Chagwa Lungu. President may be here today. Tomorrow you won't be there.
Mm.
Like you were as Vice President, today you are not. But if we can work together and solve these problems, I think it will be for our good. You should look at your children like myself and your grandchildren and great-grandchildren.
True, true.
To come and see those big trees in Solwezi. Not to just come and they find like it's an open field. You know, everything that we do should be with the interest of the future generations.
True, true. No, I agree with you, Pastor.
Mm.
Indeed, yes.
Please give us some text messages, Mr. Director, while we are waiting for the calls. Good evening, Pastor Chiluba and Honorable Kavindere Ike. That's great man, my former boss, Mr. Malanji, Patrick. Just wanted to appreciate him for the good experience.
Oh,
you remember
yes.
him, sir?
Yes, was my chauffeur.
Oh, he was your chauffeur.
Patrick, yeah? I was asking about you the other day.
Yeah. Good evening, Pastor Chiluba and your honor, Enoch Kavindere. It is unbelievable and my heart is bleeding that 10,000 plus are being displaced. From Mukushi. It is very sad indeed.
It is sad indeed. It is sad. That number of people cannot be... this place just like that. Something has gone wrong. Because certainly I do know that the president would never have agreed to something like that happening.
He can't agree.
No.
I don't think so.
No.
Hello, good evening.
Hello.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening.
Yes, sir. What's your name and where you calling us from?
Mark Chipolo. I'm calling from Mundola.
You are Mark who?
Chipolo.
Mark Chipulu.
Yes.
From Mundola.
Yes.
Please go ahead and contribute to the nation.
Yeah. Good evening, Your Honor, former Vice President.
Good evening, Bwana Chipulu. Thank you.
Yeah, good evening, Pastor Chiluba.
Good evening to you, sir.
Yes, we are privileged to have such a program.
Yes, sir.
Talking about national matters, and we really appreciate.
Yes, sir.
That indeed we have a bank of knowledge from people that have been there before.
Mm-hmm.
And we appreciate whatever the former vice president is actually talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and we are also learning about the importance of us Zambians. Being the job creator, we have resources, natural resources, those minerals, almost everywhere. I'm a mining engineer by profession. I know what we are talking about. And the issue that we are facing with the country, where we have a weak current, and we complaining about displacement, where we just feel like investors, foreign investors are the ones that can solve this problem. It will never be like that. Only us to solve those problems. And indeed, Pastor Chiluba, you read what the Vice President, former Vice President is talking about. Yeah, even on your part, I know you are willing the access to talk to the President, where we can have an idea of what has gone wrong and as a country. And basically, this is what we want.
Mm-hmm.
The first thing they have to do is to admit to say something is wrong. If only somebody admits that something is wrong, then that's when that person can be helped.
Mm.
I know even the former vice president, the details can comment that and that, but we know the exact way we have a problem with that, the national problem, and we need to fix it.
Mm.
These natural resources that we are having, we are always looking for foreign investors to resolve any crisis. Indeed, as you pastor mentioned, these natural resources can only be utilized by us Zambians. Because even the money will remain in Zambia.
Mm.
The foreign investors, they have managed to just to get Africa or Zambia. And this is the thing that we are encouraging and we are appreciating that you people are coming up. The local government, I know the government is listening, although it's a bit selective what they do, but we need it where all the youth, exactly, for their participation are brought on board. All the same. So there's no problem with the men now.
Your line, Mr. Chipolo. Hello? Oh,
It's gone.
But you heard your honor what he's talking about.
Not really. Everything.
He's thanking the Lord, of course, for the fact that you are there.
Thank
as
you
a
very
reservoir,
much.
And that what I said about you meeting His Excellency the President, he was saying that he just hopes the government is listening, because people like yourself are an asset, you know.
Yes.
And I think what makes great leadership, Your Honor, is that even if I'm wrong, you criticize me. My lecturer used to say that in every criticism, look for the grain of truth. When people criticize you, look for the grain of truth. Don't take every criticism as evil or somebody is after your life. But in every criticism, take stock. What you have offloaded here, Your Honor, of how we can control the Kwacha, it doesn't take an economist to know that once the Bank of Zambia governor and the minister put measures to say, Vane, let's use Kwacha. We want to know where it's coming. These things, we can control it. This is our country.
Oh, yes.
Mm?
Oh, yes.
Mr. Director, please give us the phone calls and the messages. Good evening. Can the former VIP update us on the progress with Northwestern rail lines?
All right.
Yeah, please. Okay. And somebody said, the pastor asked the former vice president for us.
Yes.
Update us on that, sir.
The update to the Northwestern Railway Company is this, that we've not had issues finding the money for the project. We've had the Development Bank of Southern Africa. We've had the African Development Bank all willing to finance the project, but on condition that the mines there give us what are known as offtake agreements. Offtake agreements are equal to something like you wanting to build a mall. At every mall there has to be a very big shop, that's an anchor shop. And that anchor shop then will attract smaller
shops.
Yes. In the Northwestern province, the biggest mines there are Kansanshi and
Lumwana
and Kalumbila, Trident. The mines have been quite reluctant to use the rail for reasons best known to themselves. They are happy seeing those trucks coming onto this newly tarred road, damaging the road the way it is. Yes. They have not been helpful at all. That has been the problem. The rail line would have been built a long time ago if what we thought happened, which was that the mines would come and say, now, oh, let's work together. Yes. I have never gone to the mines to ask them for money, because the money for the project is within the African Development Bank and with the Development Bank of Southern Africa, who were even phoning me yesterday. What has happened now is that a very big company in Russia has come to us. We've signed with them, called TMH, that they are willing to build that railway with us. Whether the mines are interested or not, they want to build, because they say that province, including the Lobito corridor going into Angola, there's so much that could be found there. Even other mines could open there. They are interested in opening up mines there. But they are saying, in the absence of a rail, we cannot. So really, I've not said this before openly, but I think, because you've asked me open, I must give you the correct answer. It's the mines that have delayed this project. At one time, in the beginning, they were quite forthcoming. They even offered to take some shares in the project. We said, yes, that's how it should work on a very big project. But along the route, they changed. And the reason, when I asked them, is that they have issues of taxation with the Zambian government. Until those issues are resolved with the Zambian government, they are not too sure which way they are going. So that is what has delayed the project. But those that have come are saying, no. Your taxation issues with the government of Zambia is up to you. We want to work. We want to build this rail. So as far as I know now, that the feasibility studies, everything has been done before and ready for us to go onto the ground. And that is what we are doing now. That's what we are doing.
Your Honor, may I ask?
Yes, sure.
Building this rail line, will it be economical viable like Tazara?
Much more. Yes, we are building. The line has been designed to carry 5 million tons of cargo. So from Northwestern, there will be five. There is already 5 million tons of cargo, which would come from there to Chingola. Then in Chingola, now we transship and put on Zambia Railways. And Zambia Railways will then go to Durban or go to Dar es Salaam. Yes, either.
Is this a short corridor for some goods?
Yes, it is. Certainly it is, because those goods that are in the Northwestern province have a big market in Angola. It's the agricultural produce. Angola spends about $2 billion a year importing meat from Brazil. And they're saying, but this is what you in Zambia could do. Yes, produce the beef, sell it to us in Angola. We want to trade. And also in Angola, they cannot trade without a rail. Yes, to go to Malawi, whatever, they have to pass through Zambia to go to, you know, all these other countries here.
They have to
pass through Zambia.
And eventually you have to put a passenger train?
Yes, yes, a passenger train will be there. But, you know, once the road is properly done up, we expect that the bus operators will also be there. Indeed, they are taking people there to our ladies' cross-border operations and things like that. There's a lot of trade that Angola can do with Zambia. But the problem has always been, you can't go to Angola with a big truck. You may use a small Hilux or small Land Rover, things like that, but very big trucks at the moment cannot go, because bridges were blown up during the Civil War. Yes, and they are doing their best to correct the situation. And Zambian ministers were there 2 weeks ago, and certainly were very impressed with what the Angolans want to do. And we are there to do it. As you know, Northwest Rail is partly, government has a 30% shareholding in it. They are not putting in any money at all, the government of Zambia, but they have said that the route that the railway will use, which of course everything belongs to government, they will support us by giving us the railway route. Indeed. So that is what's happened. It's the mines that are there.
Now, your honor, you are saying that it's the mines. Again, please forgive me for the questions I'm asking. Having been vice president,
yes,
you always exchange notes with the president.
Yes.
Can't our president instruct those mines to say we need your backing in this? Because it's delaying our economy's growth.
Yes.
Can't the president issue a word?
Yes, he can. Indeed, he can. In fairness to all the presidents, starting from Arabi, yes, Mwanawasa, that's the time I started the project when I left, yes. They've all been very, very supportive. They put it in writing, had letters from Michael, President Sata, indeed, and everybody has been supportive. President Lungu is highly, highly supportive of the project.
Of the project.
Yes, and each time I meet him, we start off with that. But you see, there are times you don't want to report the others and their shortcomings. So I've not really hit hard on the issue of the mines, but the Development Bank of South Africa and the African Development Bank have been now to Zambian authorities saying, but these chaps are answerable to Zambian government. Zambian government is not answerable to the mines. Why are they delaying development? Here are our letters of offer, offering finance in order to build.
And that finance will help our Kwacha?
Yes, that finance will help our Kwacha indeed. Government has been highly supportive since President Lungu came onto the scene. He has supported a need for the railway to be built, and by saying 30% of all cargo must move from the roads onto rail. Because as you know, Pastor Chiluba, if you're driving from Lusaka going to Ndola, the road is so badly damaged.
Bad. Very bad.
Yes, because of these heavy, heavy trucks from South Africa. So the president has supported us by stating that, look, that 30% must go by rail. We don't have a rail in Northwestern Province, they are saying, so they can't go by rail. So for the time, what comes out first, is it a chicken or egg situation? But I think it's been resolved now.
When God is involved, it's the chicken, then the egg will follow.
Indeed, indeed.
Yeah. Honorable, you have blessed the people of Zambia on this, and I know for sure that the ministers, you are listening. Please play your part, because you are not in that seat forever. Play your part. Let's see that Zambia moves. We should be able to come together. Here is the situation, Honorable. In some countries or some quarters, people would be jealous because it's Honorable Kavindere, average to spearhead. And there is that human instinct. Ngatamuli nchekelepu hapa, shasa inefima paper. You know, there are those human instincts that come in. But I pray that God, as you are saying, that the president is supportive of this. All of you ministers, permanent secretaries, this is a national issue. It is not about Mr. Kavindere's line. It's about the economy. These are things that we should tackle without being intimidated. May God bless this nation. Yes, sir. You wanted to say something?
No, I was saying to you, Pastor, that thank you very much for those remarks. Unfortunately, in this country, we are not really accustomed to the idea of assisting each other.
Mm.
We fight each other.
I know.
When there's no need to fight.
No battle.
We are not like Nigerians or Kenyans.
Nah, I'm Chinese.
Yes. Those Kenyans, if I find one with the marijuana or whatever, they'll say, no. You may know police. You are the ones who brought. Yes. Nigerians are like that. They support each other. Here, you know,
they will sell you.
I have this experience with the Vodacom. You remember Vodacom?
Yes, Vodacom,
yes, by the way. Yes, I applied for a license because I was the only one who applied.
Mm.
And I won the tender.
Yes, sir.
And after winning the tender, now getting ready, they said, no. We'll take him to court. So we went to court.
Mm.
The very people who wanted the Vodacom, the fourth license operator here, are the ones who went to court after I had won the tender.
Mm.
And the court asked, the judge asked, said, but who are the others who applied? And, no, he was the only one. So if he was the only one, why have you brought him here? At the end of it all, I won the case.
Mm.
Now, after winning the case, they came back, those that are in power, they came back and said, now look, we'll appeal.
Mm.
So indeed they appealed, but before we could be heard in the appeal court, somebody very high was sent to me.
Mm.
Say, go and talk to Kavindele. And if he gives us some shares in that company, then he'll have it
on his own.
So when that person came, I was with my son and said, look, go out, allow us to talk to this gentleman who has come from, high government office. And when they says, no, look, I'm here to make an offer to you that you have won the case, but we have the powers to appeal. Now, if you give us some shareholding or have been sent, that if some shares are given, then
you have
the license.
Mm.
So I said, but in this country, I thought we were all fighting corruption.
Mm.
Yeah, isn't this corruption?
Mm.
So I said, no. At times, it's nice to be poor with the owner. So I will not fall to those standards.
Mm.
Appeal. Let the courts decide.
And you still have that license?
I was given a license, approved everything, advertised by government newspapers. It's been given to Vodacom. Now, Vodacom, after waiting for a while, said, now look, we are a public company and we cannot wait forever.
Mm.
So we are going. When you Zambian people are ready, you call us.
Mm.
But, you know, they put lots of
spanners
in the works. So my colleagues went and what remained was, they went to Supreme Court. There the judgment now was different.
Mm.
But I knew what had happened because right now the people who are involved tell me, some of them apologized to me, said, look, we are sorry that this happened, but you know, we were just employees of, were sent by higher authorities, things like that. So I said, okay. Now they failed up to now. They gave it to President Santos's daughter. Now they failed. Now they want 12 million for a license. And, we are waiting to see which Zambian will have $12 million to buy that, to get a license, which I got for $2.3 million, indeed. So that is also one problem. Anyone wanting to go into business in this country must know that you're on your own. Our people are not versed to the idea of supporting each other.
Mm.
Yes, they want to bring you down.
But this, honorable, sorry to, it's a sad story.
It is.
Because you are a Zambian.
Mm.
And that money, even if you became as wealthy as Dangote, we will be proud of you.
Right.
To say this thing is owned by former president. And not only that, your contributions and helping to this nation will be because you are a Zambian.
Yes.
I don't understand. Anyway, may God help us. Honorable, I can tell you, you are a blessing. These things are for this world. If you don't get it and everything, you've done your best. There's nothing that you can do, you can prove. You have no reason to prove to anybody that you are capable.
Indeed.
You know.
Thank you very much, Pastor. Thank you.
So we are very grateful. And please go back to my president. Okay. You know, him being a lawyer and these things. Probably, I pray that he's watching. President Lung watches this channel so much with our mother. And I pray that he's watching. Because somebody could have just sat on the lessons without even...
Oh, yes. Knowing. No, I do know how these things work. Indeed. You see, being president is such a demanding job. Yes, that you are really dependent on very many people. Some of them good people who have the interests of the nation at heart. Others...
Foxes.
Yes, in their own interests, their personal...
They come to chew.
Indeed, personal interests and then making the president... A president can virtually fall or fail depending on the people that surround him.
Around him.
Yes.
This is why as a church we always pray for the president, because that's not an easy job.
No, it's not an easy job at all. It's not an easy job. You know, there are times I would go to visit your late namesake there.
President Chiluba.
President Chiluba. I know, open, and there he is. You know, you think the president is looking at you. President's deep in thought, thinking about things. Or just come and sit there. Then later on, I say, Vice President, welcome. What to drink would you want? Say, water, sir. Say, is that all? Say, yes, please, that's all. You know, things are, it's a very, very demanding job. A lot of people see pomp in it. No, it's going to fly
just
there.
Just sirens and
yes, sirens and there.
They say even me, I will be a president.
Oh, I tell you.
Let's pick up this call, Honorable. Hello, good evening.
Mr.
Kadiota, now you are talking.
Thank you so very much.
Yes, sir.
First, you and foremost, I would love to thank God for the Almighty to give you this chance to speak to the people in this land.
Correct.
God bless you.
Amen.
Another thing that I want to talk about is on the land which I talked about.
Yes, sir.
This land belongs to the Zambian.
Yes, sir.
Not the foreigners.
Absolutely.
If we go back to our senior language in your chant, they say,
That is in Lozi?
No, Luchanzi, yes. My tribe.
Oh, that's your tribe. Say that what you said again. I want to hear it from Honorable. His Honor.
Okay, what he's saying is that when you are given perhaps cassava,
yes,
to
sir.
Pound,
yes,
so that Google Shim.
Yes.
Now, says the people that have come are not really pounding for the love of you people to prepare Shima for you. But they just want to break things and then go back.
Absolutely.
I see, Mr. Gayat.
Yes, please go ahead.
Exactly. So that's what I want to say, that these people have just come to destroy our land and then after you go. So, another thing that I want to say, let's get to the privilege of the honorable in your meeting.
Amen.
Let him be the instrument or the mouthpiece to the government, or just get to know the government that he has for this experience.
Amen.
He has served in UNIP, he has served in Manawasa, that's experience enough for the government to learn from him. The point that you raised, that he can bring him and all the prominent people that have served in the bigger government can share the ideas how we can develop our country, sure we can be of that nature. So, that is the, I feel we can also like him contribute this year.
Mr. Kadiota, thank you so much for now. Your phone is clear, and tomorrow when we repeat this program, you hear yourself very clearly. Honorable.
Thank you.
Your Honor, you've got an assignment.
Yes, Pastor.
My wife and I are lonely voices, and sometimes you speak like this. Others, depending on which fence they are on, my wife and I have been called PF. We have been called UPND, we have been called names, and people have called me Kadas, but it doesn't bother me.
No.
My fight is for this nation.
Correct.
If we can have you, sir, with the other presidents, like General Miyanda, I'm insisting, those people, you listen to the wisdom, to the things that are brought here. Surely, we are a great nation. We can't fail. Ututuma problems to Motule Pitamo, your honor. Kutimwa sova imo. You've gone before us.
Oh, yes. No, we've had these problems before, and we've seen how they've been solved. And I recall talking about foreigners, what we did in UNIP, for instance. President Kaunda said, look, we want our own people to learn to trade, also to own shops and things like that.
That's right.
So many Asians who were trading in rural places were brought out of there. Say, look, our people can now learn, do know now how to sell candles and things like that.
That's right.
Yeah, so you go into bigger places. So those mostly Indians left to be places like, if you go to Magoi, you see where their shops were. Now they are brought in Lusaka, brought in second class trading area there after our people had already learned. So as a government, whatever we do must certainly be in the interest of our people. And I do know that that's a president, that's what is giving him sleepless nights, because he's aware that the exchange rate certainly is not working in favor of our ordinary people, ordinary Zambians, but in favor of individuals, those who've got maybe dollars in the banks and things like that.
International criminals.
Yes,
who have come to sabotage our country.
Indeed, like Kayata said. Yes, so, you know, people with a lot of dollars, because if you just change $1 in the bank or anywhere else, you get 21 kwacha. Now, 21 kwacha, if you're buying a Coca-Cola at 5 kwacha, that is about 4 Coca-Colas. In America, $1 does not buy you a Coke. It has to be $2.50.
Yeah, $1.
No, things like that, yeah.
$1, yeah.
So those that have got their income in dollars, or those that have dollars, should sympathize with our people in the villages who are suffering as a result of decisions that we have.
But those people, Your Honor, they cannot develop sympathy. You know, when a witch is bewitching a neighbor,
yes.
When you go with sympathy, witchcraft does not have sympathy.
No.
And these are economical witches who just want to see the president fail, the Zambian government fails, and everyone.
Right.
This is witchcraft. Mr. Director, please give us, in few minutes we are remaining with, give us some text messages. Good topic, Your Honor. What made you to withdraw in UNIP race at Mulungush Rock of Authority?
From Fulera.
Good evening, Pastor and Honorable Kavindere. Your Honor, comment something on the nation's debt.
Okay.
Good evening, Pastor Chiluba and Honorable Kavindere. These handouts, the best way to empower
people.
People. Are these handouts the best way to empower people, e.g.
marketeers
and tax drivers? Keep those topics there. Let His Honor look at them and comment.
Yes.
What made you withdraw from the Mulungush Rock of Authority?
I see. So you wanted me to be president of Zambia. Thank you very much. Thank you. But I think even after withdrawing, I didn't do too badly because I became vice president.
Yeah.
So I learned a lot during that time.
Amen.
And the idea of women undressing in front of me, whatever. But, you know, those things do happen. When minister from the UK came to Zambia, is MacLeod, you know, Machiga Monica, Julia Chiga Monica, and the other women went to...
Thank you, Mr. Director. You bring them back. Let His Honor comment.
Went there and, you know, naked and things like that. But MacLeod still carried on with his business. I still carried on with the business, but I knew that we were, as UNIP, we were going to lose. But very many of my colleagues in UNIP didn't think so, indeed. And I thank very much the late Vice President of Zambia, Ruben Kamanga, may his soul rest in peace. Yeah, who went to the president and wrote him a letter, and he said, gave me a copy, which I think I'll reproduce in my book. And he says, look, this Kavindele is not alone in thinking that UNIP will lose. Yes. Kavindele is working with his friends outside the UNIP. And indeed, when I was at Mulungushi, President, the late President Chiluba, was very concerned because he said, yeah, Nalibeshova UNIPia, Walapa Yomunensu. And I had a satellite phone, yes, at Mulungushi. So I was able to speak to people outside Mulungushi. And in his case, President Chiluba's case, he had a friend of ours called Arthur Yoyo. So he would, you know, President Chiluba was a very kind man. He would just say, look, Arthur Kalandela Kavindele Tumfwe. How is so? You say that the president wants to know how are you. I say, no, I'm okay. I'm guarded here, I have a bulletproof jacket, and I have police officers guarding me. He says, no, we are very worried. But it was good experience. And I say, from there, as I say, I became, I was already in the Central Committee of UNIP. There I became minister, four ministries before becoming vice president. So the experience was worth it.
What would you say? He said, the other one said about the debt of this nation. He said, make
good evening,
a comment.
Honorable, comment something on the nation's debt. The nation is debt, yes. It's terrible that we can fail to pay 42 million dollars.
I like what you said, Your Honor. We.
Yes.
Not the government.
No, we Zambians.
Yes.
For me, I have an idea. Maybe the wrong forum, but Pastor Chiluba wants to know. You know, if I had powers, you know what I would do? I would say, and I've been reading, that Zambians have $2.6 billion in the banks, local banks here. So I'll just instruct the governor, Bank of Zambia, say, governor, each one of us who's got a dollar account must pay 10% of the money. In other words, if the pastor has 100 kwacha in his dollar account, $10. Yes, $10 should be paid. Not taken away, but converted to kwacha. Yes. So if it's true that there's $2.6 billion in this country,
that would be about
260 million
kwacha.
Dollars.
That's
yes.
Right.
That would end this issue of being so embarrassed. Yes, I have children. My children working in the UK and in America, and when they, you know, phone, but daddy, what's this? You know, us in Zambia failing to pay $42 million. Now everybody's laughing at us when we say we are Zambians. You know, they say, but what went wrong in there? So hopefully that we can have a deal with IMF, hopefully, quite soon. But that $42 million, I think, should be paid. And the way of paying that is what I've explained, that each one of us, those, and there are very few, say we are 17 million in this country. Now, if only about, say, 500,000 Zambians own that $2.6 billion, it will not affect the suffering. No one will suffer because this thing has been evoked. But that is how I would, that's how I would tackle it myself. Yes, that.
Well, you have given the advice already.
Well,
and you know, the other thing, Your Honor, I tend to think that if Zambians are not empowered, business is in the hands of foreigners who keep on going through such things.
Oh yes.
And this is why my wife and I are promoting agriculture, so that if Zambians have the money, we can contribute.
Correct.
I'll tell you one example, Your Honor. When I saw that the women were giving birth on the tree in Mozambique, I think it was in Mozambique, when we had that flood.
Yes, yes, yes.
I was so touched that I went to President Chiluba, may he so rest in peace. I went to him, I said, sir, the Bible encourages us to say, blessed are those who give. Let's raise the money. Do you know that up to today, I contributed the money for fuel, for the... I said, if ever there will be a chopper to take blankets, as a church, we will contribute. Because our friends are going through pain. Let's, and President Chiluba understood.
Yes.
And he said, Vamashina, I will take it to cabinet. That's a very brilliant idea.
Yes.
But like you said, the president may issue instructions there. Somewhere down the chain, things didn't work. And I saw South Africans, they move in there. I was very sad, you know.
No, it's true. It's true that, but the debt is embarrassing. Yes, to us all, not only one individual. Us all. And for me, in fact,
as Zambians.
Yes, as Zambians. And for me, in fact, I would say that, you know, exempt the president from this sort of thing, because I do know how the decisions would have been affected. If these things I was talking about, those statutory instruments 33 and 55 were there, things like that would not happen.
They would not.
No, they would not. They would not. But the technocrats, we hope that they can look at this thing and certainly let's get out of this embarrassing situation. One young fella who used to be here in Zambia, but now is in South Africa, is not Zambian, sent me a text. I said, what has happened to Zambia? What have you people done to Zambia? You know, so very, very embarrassing indeed. So I think that Honorable Minister should find the money so that at least that is paid. I've given him a tip on how to find $260 million. I am not saying that he should introduce exchange control or he should... close people's accounts or whatever. No. But this, what I'm suggesting, has been done before by other countries. It's when they've run into difficulties. They've gone to people with the money and say, now look, guys, do this. And it will not affect anyone at all. You're taking 10% of people who have got... because those dollar accounts are there just for convenience, really.
Because even 5%, Your Honor,
yes,
as 5%. You have said, instead of 260, we can still remain with 100 and the 30
yes.
million and pay off that and
indeed,
keep on going.
Indeed. Yeah, that should be paid off. It's very embarrassing.
Mm.
Yes, because now everyone's talking about it. Small newspapers, these social media in India.
Social media people, I don't know why they are so happy. They write things to just bring it to the embarrassment of the nation. You know, and this is one thing, Your Honor, that Max Camnet TV, different. We say we are not just another channel. We are not going to undress the government. We are not going to undress this nation. Whatever we go through, we are going together.
Correct.
You know, as a nation.
Indeed.
So
indeed.
We are very grateful.
Thank you.
Your Honor, I am so grateful that you accepted my invitation. Please let it not be the last time. We will knock on your door and bring you up here because the nation needs your wisdom.
Thank you very much, Pastor Chiluba. I'm very grateful that you could invite me. And I'm also grateful and I must congratulate you and Madam Chiluba that Camnet, I believe, is now going global.
Yes, sir.
Indeed. So people...
It is, sir.
Yeah.
Even the Zambians in Australia and New York, they are watching right now.
Oh, my goodness.
And we receive very good feedback.
Oh, I see.
Yes, sir.
Oh, thank you very much indeed.
Once we make certain payment, sir, Camnet TV has been given the satellite signal.
Wow. For us to sit in Europe with 120 million people watching on a nice platform.
Wow.
And also in America.
Wow.
We are just believing God to raise a certain amount, and then you'll be in New York, you'll be in Beijing, you'll be watching CamNet. We have cleared all that. Yes, sir.
Oh, well done.
Yes, sir.
Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
You know, you're successful because you do these things quietly. Yeah. Yes, now sir. It's too late for anyone to stop you. Yeah. That's a way to do things in our
thank
country.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, just to do them quietly. And,
yes, sir.
Yeah. No, God bless you. Yeah. Pastor Chiruba.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, well done.
Sir, on behalf of my wife, on behalf of the leadership of our church, and of course CamNet TV, we would like to thank you most sincerely for taking your time off to be in the studio and just share with the nation and convey our love to our mother.
Thank you very much
and
indeed.
My brothers and sisters in your home.
Thank you very much indeed, Pastor. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. God bless you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Welcome, the TV viewers. I've been your host, Pastor Chiluba, on National Matters, and my guest was His Honor, the former Vice President of this great Republic of Zambia, Mr. Enoch Kavindele. What an honor and privilege. Keep watching CamNet TV, and remember, CamNet TV is not just another channel. Bye-bye.